Hello guys, welcome to H2O, the A to Z of chemistry. I'm Dr. Ritu Johar, your educator for this course. States of matter. So today we begin with lecture 7 from the course, but make sure you watch the previous ones before viewing this one. So in the last lecture, we started with a detailed discussion on the gaseous state of matter, wherein we talked about the measurable properties of these gases, that is mass, volume, pressure and temperature. So the concepts that we learned in the last lecture, especially the interconversions that we learned, they are going to be really very important for you. So please do make sure that you have watched them. Now, these four measurable properties of gases, they are interdependent and they describe the state of the gas. And there are going to be certain laws which show us how these measurable properties, they are going to be interdependent. And these laws, they are known as the gas laws. So we will be starting with a brief discussion, what is gas laws? And then we will be talking in detail about the first gas law, that is going to be the Boyle's law. So the gas laws, they are the laws which govern the behavior of the gases. And these laws, they give the relationship between the measurable properties of gases, that is mass, volume, pressure and temperature. How they are related to each other, how they are dependent upon each other, we will be learning in the various gas laws. And the various gas laws, they are going to be number one, Boyle's law, number two, Charles' law, then we have the Gay-Lussac's law, Avogadro's law. And when we have learned all these four laws, then we will be learning the combined gas law or the ideal gas equation. So this is going to be a detailed discussion on all these laws and one by one, obviously, because it has to be a detailed discussion. So we begin in this lecture with the Boyle's law. Now, before I begin with the study of this Boyle's law, there is one very interesting thing that you will be seeing in all the four laws that we will be studying, the Boyle's law, the Charles' law, the Avogadro's as well as the Gay-Lussac's law, that we have four measurable properties. Out of these four measurable properties, we will be seeing the relationship between two properties and the other two properties, we will be keeping them fixed. For example, when I talk about the Boyle's law, it is going to be a relationship between pressure and volume. Therefore, what are the two quantities that we will be keeping fixed? The mass as well as the temperature of the gas. Okay, so this is going to be seen throughout all the four laws that we will be having two constant values and the relationship between the other two. So when I talk about the Boyle's law, this Boyle's law was given by a scientist, Robert Boyle. He was an Anglo-Irish scientist and he gave this law in the year 1662. And this is going to give us a relationship between pressure and volume at constant temperature and the mass of the gas. So let us quickly see the statement for the law. And the statement says that at constant temperature, the pressure of a fixed amount of gas varies inversely with its volume. So one thing that we have kept fixed is temperature. We have constant temperature. And the other thing we have kept fixed is a fixed amount of the gas. And when we talk about the fixed amount of the gas, we talk about the mass of the gas. Actually, what we are fixing over here is the number of moles of the gas. It is not mass of the gas that we are fixing. It is the number of the moles of the gas that we will be fixing. Okay. So temperature is constant. Number of moles is going to be constant. And the pressure here will be inversely proportional to volume. So when we see the mathematical expression for this, P, which is denoting pressure, this is going to be inversely proportional to V, which is volume, at constant temperature T and constant number of moles N. So we will be fixing the amount of gas, we will be having constant temperature and pressure will be inversely proportional to volume. So what this means again, this is that if we increase the pressure, volume is going to decrease. If we decrease the pressure, volume is going to increase. And another way we can put this equation is going to be P equal to K1 into 1 upon V, where K1 is the proportionality constant. In your books, you will be seeing seen this written only as k, and we have just put it as k1 because for the other laws also you will be seeing the proportionality constants. So just wanted to distinguish them. Not otherwise, there is no other reason. So this is essentially k, a proportionality constant. Okay. So now p is equal to k into 1 upon v, and another way we can write this equation by just rearranging is going to be pv is equal to k1, or pv is equal to k. So what this means is that the product of the pressure and the volume, this will always remain constant. So for example, the pressure is 4, whatever the units are, and the volume is 2. So 4 into 2 is going to be 8. Okay, so now if I change the pressure to 2, the value of the constant, this has to remain 8, so volume will become 4. Okay, so PV, the product of pressure and volume, this will remain constant if the temperature is constant and the number of moles of the gas, they are fixed. Fine, I hope this is clear. So this means, again speaking it, writing it out, that at constant temperature, the product of the pressure and the volume of fixed amount of gas, this is going to remain constant. Now another thing what you have to remember over here, which is going to be very important for your understanding, is that the value of this constant K1, this depends upon the temperature of the gas and the number of moles of the gas. Now how do we explain this? Well, you will not be able to understand over here only. So for that, I'm just giving you the equation. That is the ideal gas equation, which you will be learning in the upcoming lectures. Okay. So this ideal gas equation, this says that PV is equal to nRT. How we have got it, you will learn it. Do not worry about that. In the upcoming lectures, you have to learn it. Okay. So I was telling you that after the four laws, we will be having the combined gas law, which we call as the ideal gas equation. And the ideal gas equation is PV is equal to nRT, where P is pressure, V is volume, N is number of moles, R is a gas constant, and T is temperature. Okay. Now, if you compare this PV equal to nRT with this equation number 3, where we have PV is equal to K1. So what this means is that PV is same on both the equations. So K1 should be equal to nRT, right? So if the constant K is equal to nRT. So this means that this value of constant, this will depend upon the temperature as well as the number of moles of the gas, because R is going to be a constant. Another one very important interpretation, okay, is going to be that K is going to be directly proportional to T. Right. So K is proportional to temperature as well as the number of moles. So what we can deduce from here, the very important relationship which I'm going to use on the next slide, is that K is directly proportional to T. If the temperature is going to increase, the value of K is going to increase. OK, so just remember it, and I will be using it on the next slide. So the next thing what you have to understand is how we are going to use the Boyle's law. And for this, one simple thing that you have to understand is that if we take supposedly a fixed amount of gas at a constant temperature T, so this is the requisite for the Boyle's law, that we have to take these two things as constant. So at this constant temperature and for a fixed amount of gas, which is occupying a volume V1 at pressure P1, this we allow it to undergo expansion. And what will happen when we allow a gas to expand? Well, the volume is going to increase. And if we allow this gas to undergo contraction, then the volume is going to decrease, right? So now we are allowing this to undergo expansion. So volume is going to increase. Let us say it increases from V1 to V2. Now, what is going to happen to the pressure according to the Boyle's law? Well, it is going to decrease because pressure and volume, they are inversely proportional. So P1, this is going to decrease, say, to P2. And how are now V1, P1 related to V2, P2? Well, this is going to be again according to the Boyle's law, that P1, V1, this will be equal to P2, V2. If we are increasing the volume, we have to decrease the pressure in such a way that P1, V1, this is equal to P2, V2, because P and V, the product, this has to remain
constant, right? So this is how we are going to apply the concept. We will be learning more about it in the numericals that we will be doing on this, but that would be in the next lecture, where I will be talking only about the questions from the Boyle's law. Okay, the next thing we can put this equation in another way is going to be that P1 by P2, this is equal to V2 by V1. The only thing that you have to remember is that we will be taking a fixed amount of gas and the temperature has to be constant. Now, the next thing that we have to learn over here, and which is going to be the more important thing, that is going to be the graphs related to the Boyle's law. And these are very important. They are asked in the examination, so you should be thorough with them. So the first graph I have is this one over here, which is between pressure and volume. And now you already know that pressure, we have P, this is equal to K over V, or I can write this as K over 1 by V. So this is what I have taken on the y-axis, pressure, and this part 1 by V, we have taken it on the x-axis. So if I took put P to be Y, 1 by V to be X, and I take K supposedly to be M, what this becomes is an equation for a straight line which is passing through origin. Okay, had this not been passing through origin, we would have written the straight line equation as Y is equal to MX plus C. And what C means is that what point the straight line is touching or cutting the y-axis. Had this C been some value, say 2 or 3, it would have been cutting the line from here and our line would have been passing through the y-axis at this way, this point. Okay, so this is the way if it would have been some value for C. But now, because the value of C is not here, this means it is 0. So my line is going to pass through the origin. That is one thing that you have to understand. Okay. Now, the other thing is that when we are going to draw this graph, what are we getting is that Y, now this is P, volume 1 by V, this is X. And what is now M over here? M is this K over here. And what does M give us in a straight line graph? It is going to give us the slope of the line, right? So the medical students, they may not be understanding these things very well, but the non-medical, I hope you do not have any problems. So for the medical students, M is giving us the slope of the line. And what do we mean? What is actually the slope of the line? It is equal to tan theta, okay? So what is theta over here? Theta is this angle which our straight line is making with the x-axis. This is theta. And if you take the tan theta of this, what we get is the slope of the line, right? So now the slope of the line, this is being given to us by K. And when this is being given to us by K, one thing that you have to remember is that K, this is directly proportional to T. Okay, so if theta is going to increase, tan theta is going to increase, the slope is going to increase. Okay, and when slope is increasing, what this means over here is that K is increasing, right? Because tan theta, this is giving us the slope of the line, and the slope of the line in the equation is being represented by K. Right. So if tan theta is increasing, the value of K is increasing, and the value of K, this is dependent upon the temperature. More is going to be the temperature, more is going to be the value of K, and more is going to be the slope of the line. So if I have drawn these three lines at temperature T1, if I've drawn these three lines at temperature T1, T2 and T3, which of these is going to be a higher temperature? It is going to be T3, because at T3, the maximum value of K is what we will be getting, and maximum value of K means maximum slope, and this is going to be the maximum slope. I hope this is clear to you people. How do we say that T3 is greater than T2, greater than T1? So just let me rub these things if you have understood. Then we will be doing the next graph. right? So these are the questions which are generally asked in the examination, that you have to tell the order which is going to be greater, T3, T2 or T1. Fine. The next graph that I have for you is between PV on the y-axis and P on the x-axis, right? So what this means is, what is going to happen when we are going to increase the pressure to PV? So when we are varying the pressure, when we are increasing the pressure, what are we seeing in this graph? We are seeing that there is no change, right? So for one temperature, one thing that you have to remember over here is that one line, this is corresponding to one temperature, because the temperature remains constant. The moment we are going to change the temperature, the value of K changes, and then we will be having another set of values for P and V. Fine. So when I draw this, what you can see is that the value of PV is not changing with increase in pressure. Why is it not changing? Because we have learned that PV is going to be constant, right? So when you're going to increase the value of P, the value of V is going to decrease. As a result, PV is going to always remain constant, which we have in this line, right? Again, T3 is going to be greater than T2 is going to be greater than T1. Fine. The next graph that we have is between pressure and volume now. So pressure and volume, what you understand is that pressure, this is inversely proportional to volume. So what this means is, when the pressure is going to be high, the volume is going to be less, and when volume is going to be high, pressure is going to be less. So can you see this line? When I talk about any one line, for one line, the pressure, the temperature is going to remain the same. Okay, so each curve, this corresponds to a different constant temperature, and when this is a constant temperature, this is known as an isotherm. Okay, so a curve which is drawn at the same temperature is called as the isotherm. Now, the next thing what I was talking to you about was, again, how do we differentiate which is going to correspond to a higher temperature or a lower temperature. So for that, what you can do is, to understand this very easily, if supposedly I draw a line over here, this should be a straight line. My lines are not straight, but I hope you can understand, this should be a straight line. And when this is a straight line, this is going to be pressure for this, the pressure for all these three, they will be the same, right? So this is going to be pressure P, pressure P, pressure P. And corresponding to this, I would be having this as volume. Okay, so this is going to be volume V1, this is going to be volume V2, and this is going to be volume V3, right? So V1 is less than V2 is less than V3. Fine, I hope this is clear. But now what we know is that P into V, this is equal to K, and this is going to be constant, right? So if this pressure is constant, this means that if I am increasing the value of V, the value of K is increasing, and K, we know, is directly proportional to T. So if the volume is going to increase from V1 to V2 to V3, this means the value of K is increasing from this to this to this. This means that this is going to be the curve corresponding to the highest temperature, because for this we have the maximum K, right? So I hope this is also clear to you people, how we are drawing these curves and which temperature is going to be higher. This is very important for you to understand, because these are the most frequently asked questions in the examinations, right? So these are the three curves, and you should know which is going to correspond to a higher temperature, which is going to correspond to a lower temperature, right? Now the next thing what you have to remember over here is that when we are going to increase the pressure, as the temperature is going to become very high, the gases, they are going to start deviating from the Boyle's law, because at that point the van der Waal forces of attraction, they are going to increase. Okay, so this we will be doing further in the course. You will be learning about this also, that when we have very high pressures, what is going to happen. But just now, just remember this thing, that high pressures, the gases, they are going to deviate from the Boyle's law, and a straight line would not be obtained in the graph. That would be at very high pressures. Okay, and the other thing that I told you to remember is that each curve, this is going to correspond to a different constant temperature known as isotherm, That means it is a constant temperature plot. So these two important things also do remember along with these three important graphs and which temperature is going to be higher. This is very important and I hope I have been able to make you understand how we are going to do this. So now I will be just showing you how this law is proved experimentally. So the experiment was that we saw the effect of pressure on the volume of 0.09 mole of carbon dioxide at 300 Kelvin. And the data that I have for you, you can just see that we had taken pressure readings, we had taken volume readings. We made that into 1 by V. So we got that 1 by V readings and we also multiplied pressure and volume. And we got the PV readings. Okay, so what you know is that pressure is inversely proportional to volume. So if we are increasing the pressure, what you can see is that the volume is decreasing. Okay, so these are all experimental data, very easy to understand now. And now then we have 1 by V values. So pressure, this would be directly proportional to 1 by V. Right. So if the pressure is increasing, the value of 1 by V is increasing. Fine. It is increasing. Perfectly fine. And if I draw a product of P into V, what do I get? It should be a constant. Right. So what values I am getting, they are approximately the same, 22.4, 22.3. So these are the figures which are quite close to each other because the exactly they're not same. This is slight experimental errors that are going to incorporate into the experiment. Fine. So I now hope you remember that pressure and volume, they are going to be inversely related. If I take pressure and 1 by V, it is obviously going to be directly related. And PV, this is going to be constant. Fine. So quantitatively, the experiments of Boyle, what do they prove? Okay, so what are they proving? They are proving that the gases, they are highly compressible because when a given mass of gas, this is compressed, that is when we are increasing the P, the same number of molecules, they are occupying a smaller space. That means the V is decreasing, right? So now you understand when we are increasing the pressure, the volume is decreasing. How do we prove this experimentally? And keeping the product PV to be constant. So this means that the gases, they become dense at higher pressure. So this is something very important for you to understand the application of the Boyle's law. How do we say that pressure is inversely proportional to volume, and what we have inferred from this? We have inferred from this that as the pressure is going to increase, the volume is going to decrease. So this means that the gases, they are highly compressible. And the other thing is that as the volume is decreasing, the pressure is going to increase. So the gases, they are going to become dense. And when they become dense, what you have to understand another thing is that air at sea surface, this has greater density, right? So air at sea surface, this has greater density because it is compressed by the mass of air above it. So there's a lot of air above the air at the sea level. So this is going to be compressed by that. And therefore, what do we have? The maximum density of air at sea level. When we move to higher altitudes, for example, if we talk about the atmospheric pressure at Mount Everest, this is going to be much less, 0.5 atmosphere. Whereas at sea level, what have you learned? It is going to be 1 atmosphere, right? So the density of air, this keeps on reducing with increasing altitude. Right. So I hope this is clear to you people. So now what we have learned is that pressure and density, they are directly proportional to each other. When we are going to increase the pressure, the density is going to increase, and we can deduce this relationship mathematically also from the Boyle's law. So let us see the relationship between density and the pressure of a gas. So we know from the equation of the Boyle's law that P1 by P2, this is equal to V2 by V1. So supposedly at pressure P1, the density of the gas is D1, and pressure P2, the density of the gas is D2, and the mass for the gas that has to be constant. Okay, so D1 we can write this as mass over V1, right? So M over V1 because density is mass over volume, and D2 is going to be M over V2 because mass we have kept constant. So we can write V1 is equal to M over D1, V2 we can write as M over D2. We will be substituting the value of V2 and D1 in the equation. So what we will be getting is P1 by D1 equal to P2 by D2, or we can say that P by D, this is going to be equal to constant. Let that constant be K. So we can write this as P equal to KD, or we can say that P is going to be directly proportional to density, right? So this is how we prove mathematically that pressure is going to be directly proportional to density. So that would be all for this lecture. I hope you have enjoyed the lecture. You understood everything. The next lecture, we would be taking up a few questions on the Boyle's law, which is going to make your concept even stronger. So that would be all. Have a nice day. God bless you. In case any doubts, please feel free. Most welcome. Mail us at h2ochemistry@gmail.com. You can also join us on our Facebook page by the same name, h2ochemistry. And also you can put your doubts in the comment section. Please do subscribe to the channel so that you get the notifications for the coming up lectures. Do click on the bell icon as well. Before leaving, one last request. Please do click on the like link if you have liked the lecture. Thank you again. Bye-bye.